Welcome to Spotlight on Migraine, hosted by the Association of Migraine Disorders. Join us for fresh perspectives by medical experts and advocates as we explore the spectrum of migraine and dig deeper into this complex disease. Dr. Deena Kuruvilla joins us to talk about Lasmiditan, a new acute treatment for migraine. She discusses results from Lasmiditan research studies, how it works, efficacy, side effects, dosing, and access.
I'm Deena Kuruvilla. I am a neurologist and headache and facial pain specialist at the Yale School of Medicine. I'm so glad that you all could join me today to discuss Lasmiditan, an exciting new rescue treatment for migraine. I really look forward to going through some of this data today, some of the slides, and seeing how Lasmiditan fits into the other existing rescue therapies that we have. So let's get started. So here on slide two, these are priorities for migraine rescue treatments that patients report. There have been surveys that have been sent out to migraine patients that specifically asked what matters most to you about your rescue treatment, about your acute treatment. And in those studies, it was identified that around 87% of patients prioritized complete elimination of pain, and 83% of folks prioritized rapid onset for the relief of their headaches. And so looking at these survey studies and seeing what patients really prioritize, it was really interesting to see that that was incorporated into the clinical trials for Lasmiditan. So in the trial for Lasmiditan, one of the primary endpoints is what was the percentage of patients who had complete elimination of their pain. And so we will touch on that today and kind of see, you know, how did this trial match up to what patients really want? So here on slide three, I have some questions for us to answer today. So the first question is, how does Lasmiditan treat migraine? That's the biggest question. What is the mechanism? Why do we think that it works? The second question is, how do I know Lasmiditan is effective? We'll go through that, some of that data as well. What are the potential side effects of the medication? What are the doses available? And how do I get the medication? What is the process that I probably need to go through to obtain this medication? So we will touch on that today as well. So how does Lasmiditan treat migraine? So it is a first-in-class medication, the first migraine rescue treatment that specifically works and activates the 5-HT1F serotonin receptor. Thus far, you know, triptans have been a tried and true treatment for migraine since the early 90s, but they have a different mechanism of action. Lasmiditan really works differently in order to provide a different mechanism for pain relief. So up to this point, we've had triptans, but I think we all know that triptans have their limitations. We typically don't use triptans in folks who have a history of cardiovascular disease, a history of heart attack, history of stroke, uncontrolled diabetes, uncontrolled hypertension, because triptans specifically work at the level of the blood vessel to constrict the blood vessel. So that is one huge way that Lasmiditan is differentiated from triptans, and we're going to go into more of that, those details today. We found through basic science research that the 5-HT1F receptor is involved in pain pathways. It's present in the central pain pathways and the peripheral pain pathways. And activation at this receptor has been found to block pain pathways, to inhibit them, and also to inhibit the release of specific neurotransmitters and neuropeptides. So that's just one idea on how it may be helpful for folks who have migraine as a rescue treatment. So here on slide five, this diagram specifically shows the differences between the triptans and this new first-in-class medication, Lasmiditan. So triptans are agonists at the 5-HT1B and the 5-HT1D receptors. B for blood vessel. So triptans do are present, can activate the blood vessels because these serotonin receptors are present on blood vessels. And triptans have less affinity for 5-HT1F, for that specific receptor. That's where lasmiditan comes in. So you can see here the different receptors and the affinity of triptans and ditans for their respective receptors. It's really, really what divides them and also gives us a different mechanism, a different option for rescue treatment, for the rescue treatment of migraine. You know, this might be a medication that we consider lasmiditan in folks with a history of cardiovascular disease, a history of stroke or heart attack, uncontrolled hypertension, uncontrolled diabetes, because it doesn't work at the level of the blood vessel as much as triptans do. So that's a kind of a key takeaway from this slide. So there were two large clinical studies specifically looking at the rescue treatment of migraine in episodic migraine patients. So in patients who are having less than 15 headache days a month, lasmiditan was studied. Lasmiditan was looked at across these two specific trials, Spartan and Samurai. And we'll go over some of the differences between the two trials. Basically, one included patients with a history of cardiovascular disease, history of heart attack, stroke, deep vein thrombosis, and one study did not include those patients. The Samurai study did not include those patients. So across these two clinical trials, over 4,000 adult patients were enrolled. 41% had two or more cardiovascular risk factors. Patients in the trial had to at least have migraine for 1 year to be enrolled. And at baseline, patients had 3 to 8 migraine attacks per month. Patients were asked to take the study drug medication within 4 hours of their headache starting and when the pain was moderate to severe. So in the Spartan study, our study that included patients with cardiovascular disease, 50 milligrams, 100 milligrams, and 200 milligrams were included. In the Samurai study, where cardiovascular patients were not included, 100 milligrams and 200 milligrams were specifically studied. And so slide 7 here gives a graphical depiction of what patients asked for, what was important to them. Pain freedom. When am I going to get pain freedom if I take this rescue medication? And so this is a graphical depiction looking at the placebo dose, 50 milligram dose, 100 milligram dose, and 200 milligram dose. And according to this, the higher in the dose, that you can see with the 200 milligram dose, when compared with the lower doses and placebo, folks were much more likely to have pain freedom at 2 hours, looking at the pool data from these two studies. So we can see here the time in hours to when patients had pain freedom. So from hour 0 to hour 2, so we can see that percentage kind of going up of pain freedom. So slide 8 here, 31 to 35% of patients had pain freedom at 2 hours if the drug was dosed from 0 to 2 hours from the onset of migraine, when compared to the placebo group, which was 19%. 20 to 36% of patients had pain freedom at 2 hours if the drug was dosed at that 2 to 4 hour mark. Because remember, in the trial, patients were asked to take the drug within 4 hours of when their headache started, when the pain was moderate to severe. So the 31 to 35% who had pain freedom at 2 hours, they took the drug at 0 to 2 hours since the migraine onset. 20 to 36% who had that pain freedom at 2 hours took the drug at between hours 2 and 4 from the migraine onset. And that's compared with placebo having 15% headache freedom at 2 hours in that group. So the next slide focuses on the most bothersome symptom. So many migraine patients tell us, it's not just the pain that's bothering me. I have to be concerned about nausea. I have to be concerned about photophobia. I have to be concerned about photophobia. So those other symptoms were looked at as well in this trial. In this particular trial, they looked at what percentage of patients were able to achieve complete freedom of their most bothersome symptom within 2 hours. At that two-hour mark, right? So we're seeing that with the most bothersome symptom, and around 40 to 49% of folks had complete freedom from their most bothersome symptom at 2 hours if they took the 200 milligram dose. We're seeing around 40% of folks had complete freedom from the most bothersome symptom at 2 hours if they took the 50 or the 100 milligram dose. And we're seeing around 30% of folks had complete freedom from the most bothersome symptom at 2 hours if they were in the placebo arm. So it's just a nice way to be able to look at some of this information taken from both trials and see how can we translate that into real life. How likely are folks be able to get rid of that photophobia, sensitivity to light, sensitivity to loud noise, and nausea? It's very important. So our next slide here focuses on side effects. We all want to know, how likely am I to have side effects to the medication? So around when we're looking at dizziness, which was the most common side effect, lightheadedness is the most common type of dizziness in this in these folks who had the side effect. We do see this dose-dependent response. So as the dose goes higher, folks may be more likely to have lightheadedness, have that dizziness. 9% of people who took 50 milligrams of Lasmiditan, also known as Reval, is the brand name, had dizziness. 15% of folks had dizziness in the 100 milligram arm, and 17% had dizziness in the 200 milligram arm, when compared to 3% in the placebo group that had the same dizziness. Other side effects that people reported were fatigue, paresthesias, sedation, nausea or vomiting, and muscle weakness. And that I stated those in the order of how commonly they happen. So things to be cautious about. Reval was specifically studied in healthy people to see if there was effects on sleepiness and driving ability using a simulated driving test. So Reval, Lasmiditan, is a controlled substance and has to be prescribed by a doctor. And there is a driving restriction on it based on these simulated driving studies that looked at healthy people who took the medication. I advise patients not to drive or operate heavy machinery for 8 hours after taking the dose. And that's because they did find that folks did have some difficulties with that simulated driving test, and that folks were still sleepy around that 8 hour mark after taking the medication. So that is extremely important. No driving or operating heavy machinery for 8 hours after taking it. Dizziness was another common side effect, which we spoke about, that I always tell folks about to just watch out for. Serotonin syndrome. Just as we see with any drug that works on serotonin receptors, with our antidepressant medications or with our Triptan, for example, there's always a risk for serotonin syndrome, which is comprised of a constellation of symptoms, such as muscle stiffness, fevers, changes in thinking. So I always ask people on follow-up visits if they're having any of these symptoms to make sure I'm not missing serotonin syndrome, which is an emergency and should be evaluated right away in the emergency room. I always counsel folks about medication overuse headache, not to use their as-needed medications like Reval too much, or you can end up having a much worse and continuous headache. Allergy. I always counsel folks about potential allergy with the medication. And again, it is a scheduled substance, a controlled substance. And so there were higher drug liking scores with Rayvow. And so there's just something to be cautious about. You know, there could be this risk of dependency. The drug liking scores for Rayvow were lower than alprazolam, but there is still that likability there. So just be cautious of that risk of dependence. It is not approved in pregnancy and lactation, so should not be considered in those cases. So there are three dosing options for Rayvow. We're here on slide 12, 50 milligrams, 100 milligrams, and 200 milligrams. You can only take the drug once. It should not be repeated because that second dose was not shown to have any additional benefit. So no more than one dose in 24 hours. Doesn't matter if you took the 50, the 100, or the 200. You cannot repeat the dose. We have that driving restriction. Should not operate heavy machinery or drive for 8 hours after taking. And there is a savings card that's available for the drug. So I usually prescribe the medication for my patients after having a pretty good discussion, lengthy discussion about how it works, the side effects, you know, going over if they're comfortable with it. And then I prescribe the medication. I always give them a copay card, which is also available online, and they're able to activate that by calling the number on that card, and then they can proceed to the pharmacy to try and get the medication at as low as a $0 copay for the next following year for commercially insured patients. So just a little tip there on how to be able to get the medication effectively, and also how to discuss the medication with your headache provider. You know, maybe Rayvow is right for you, and maybe it's not, but it's certainly worth knowing about all these exciting migraine medications that are coming out this year and all of them that are slated to come out in the coming years. So I thank you so much for your attention today.
Thank you for tuning into Spotlight on Migraine. For more information on migraine disease, please visit migrainedisorders.org.